like to take a moment to welcome everyone today to the Church of St. Joan of Arc. We welcome you wherever you are on your journey. Let us begin our celebration today with the sign of our faith. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And with your spirit.
Again, I welcome everyone today. My name is Father Jim Cassidy, and I'm joined today by Linda Muldoon, who will be our reader today. We welcome you, the parish of St. Joan of Arc. We also welcome our extended guests and family who have found us on YouTube and are tuning in to us. We welcome everyone today again as we celebrate. We as a faith community, once again, are called to be a people of peace, a people of justice. Our journey continues to be most unique as we spend this time physically apart. I've been in touch with many people over the last weeks, and I'm hearing more and more of the stress as we go past the six-month mark of this most unique journey. Harder sometimes to find that peace, harder to find that sense of centeredness when we find ourselves apart from one another. So I want us today, as we begin this celebration, to focus particularly on that importance of peace and how we need to find that within. I want to begin by sharing this very brief reading that occasionally helps me find that peace. If you pay attention to the patterns of your life, you'll realize everything always works out. Everything takes you to a greater destination. You always grow in the things that you think you cannot survive. You somehow divinely make it through. That is life. Let us always remember that. The peace of the Lord be always with you. May we continue to search and to seek that peace in our own hearts and never miss the opportunity to share that peace with the world around us. As we gather today again, we are ever mindful of our quest, our mission for justice. The gospel today invites us again in a very strong parable form once again from Matthew to think about justice and at times how difficult it is to find that justice. For the times in which we fail to look, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And we extend our prayer today into the world in which we live. Pope Francis says the coronavirus pandemic has proved that the magic theories of market capitalism have failed and that the world needs a new type of politics that promotes dialogue and solidarity and rejects war at all cost. Francis has laid out his vision for a post-COVID world by uniting core elements of his social teachings into a new encyclical aimed at inspiring a revised sense of the human family. God of hope, hear us.
God of hope, hear us.
The current administration is poised to push for further cuts in refugee resettlement programs. The most recent proposed would bring the nation's refugee population to an all-time low. In Minnesota, the number of refugees coming into the state has dropped dramatically in the last 3 years. From 2,635 in the year 2016 to only 848 in 2019. Refugee advocates say the administration is dismantling a program that has long enjoyed bipartisan support and has been considered a model for protecting the world's most vulnerable people. God of justice, hear us.
God of justice, hear us.
Amid a national debate about voting rights for felons, the Minnesota District of U.S. Probation and Pretrial Services is seeking to better inform felons of their right to vote in the coming election. Taking advantage of a state law that allows ex-convicts to register and vote once they have completed their probation. Minnesota is one of just 19 states that extends that right. But unfortunately, it is not common knowledge among many ex-offenders. God of freedom, hear us.
God of freedom, hear us.
And may Almighty God forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Gentle and loving God, once again, we do give you thanks for the opportunity of gathering. We give you thanks, as always, for your peace, your compassion, and love. As we hear today's gospel, I pray that you open our hearts and our spirit to a renewed sense of hope. May we be willing again to dig deeper into our hearts and our spirit to bring about justice and peace to the world. Open our hearts to the scripture that we are hearing today. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our reader this morning is Linda Muldoon.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples a feast of rich food and choice wines, juicy, rich food and pure choice wines. On this mountain, God will destroy the shroud that veils all people, the web that is woven over all nations. God will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from every face. The reproach of his people God will remove from the whole earth. For the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, "Behold our God to whom we looked to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that God has saved us. For the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain." The responsorial psalm, I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures, he gives me repose. Beside restful waters, he leads me. He refreshes my soul. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. You guide me in right paths for your name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil. For you are at my side with your rod and your staff that give me courage. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. You spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. Sisters and brothers, I know how to live in humble circumstances. I also know how to live with abundance. In every circumstance and in all things, I have learned the secret of being well-fed and of going hungry, of living in abundance and of being in need. I can do all things in him who strengthens me. Still, it was kind of you to share in my distress. O my God, will fully supply whatever you need in accord with his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. All glory to our God forever and ever. Amen. This, my family, is God's word to us.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Our gospel reading today is taken from the Gospel of St. Matthew. Jesus again in reply spoke to the chief priests and the elders of the people in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who gave a wedding feast for his child. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the feast, but they refused to come. A second time he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those invited, behold, I have prepared my banquet. My calves and fattened cattle are killed, and everything is ready. Come to the feast.' Some ignored the invitation and went away. One went to their farm, and another went to their business. The rest laid hold of his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged and sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy to come. Go out, therefore, into the main roads and invite to the feast whomever you find.' The servants went out into the streets and gathered all that they found, bad and good alike. And the hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to meet the guests, he saw a man there not dressed in a wedding garment. And the king said to him, 'My friend, how is it that you came in here without a wedding garment?' But he was reduced to silence. Then the king said to his attendants, 'Bind his hands and feet, cast him into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Many are invited, but few are chosen.'" This, my family, is a reading of the good news of our salvation.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Again, a word of welcome today as we continue to experience and hear multiple parables these last weeks from Matthew. So true for this weekend. Yet another one of Matthew's Gospels that once proclaimed, I conclude, as you heard me this morning, this is the good news of our salvation. When I hear the rough and tumble of the parable, I imagine you're really thinking to yourself when I say, this is the good news, and you're thinking, really? What does the bad news sound like? As we heard, bind his hands and feet and cast him into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Many are invited, but few are chosen. The use of parable is designed specifically to make us work a little harder at digging as to what the actual meaning of the scripture is. One could ask, what becomes of "we welcome you wherever you are on your journey"? The very word gospel translates to be good news. As indicated in several parables, Matthew's church community had real struggles and questions as to who really did belong to the church community and who did not. They had, early in our history, begun to decide who was really a part of this and who wasn't. Regrettably, an unfortunate, divisive dynamic that has continued to plague our entire history as a faith community. we still can get into the business of deciding who's really a Christian and who isn't. Simply being in church did not make one holy or God's chosen or by any means necessarily a paragon of virtue. By simply being in the church, or more directly stated, spending time in a garage does not necessarily qualify you to be a car. There's a certain harshness to the gospel. But again, it draws us to try to understand exactly what Matthew meant by this gospel. Given all that we as a nation and as a church are challenged to deal with every day, it is little wonder that we are more drawn to images of God that instill comfort. Today's responsorial psalm that Linda read, Psalm 23, as we all know, is a crowd favorite for funeral prayer cards. But I suggest it's a bit late to provide comfort for the dearly departed. It has a little bit of comfort for everyone, regardless of where you came from. I, who grew up in Nebraska, am drawn to, in verdant pastures, the Lord gives me repose. For the many of you who grew up in Minnesota, we hear in that psalm, by restful waters, the Lord leads me. The Lord refreshes my soul. Even though I walk in this dark valley, I fear no evil. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life. The Lord is indeed our shepherd, and we are still struggling with many wants, many fears, and many concerns. To name a few obvious ones. The COVID-19 pandemic managed to drop a bombshell in the middle of the White House Rose Garden. As of today, 211,844 men, women, and children have died in the U.S. In Minnesota alone, 2,087 deaths, 105,740 infections. Another struggle that we're all facing. The systematic racism continues to tear the fabric of our nation and is free to escalate by receiving a less than subtle green light from the highest level of our national government. We all experienced in the last days a national presidential debate that should have afforded everyone viewing the option to be pre-medicated prior to watching. Today's gospel would seem to disturb, if not contradict, the warm and comforting images of Psalm 23. Today's gospel is meant to challenge the superficial notion that our lives will be free of suffering and opposition. In our new journey where life is simply not the same. Having the luxury amid singing plenty of good room is becoming a fond and regrettably a distant memory. We now have a deeper appreciation for what it means when we hear the words, "Don't go to church, be the church." Again, I am grateful that we acknowledge this pandemic as a faith community and take it very serious. I am more than grateful that we honor science and solid medical information that gives us not only a little choice, but the right choice in how we choose to live as a community. Our faith in Jesus is the same, but the contours of our mission will need imagination and courage. Before preaching peace, Jesus consistently spoke of a love that seeks justice. It is a love that takes seriously the dignity of every single person. Pro-life is pro-life for all forms of life. And it is a love that seeks to bring change in our ideas about how we are actually functioning in our society and in our larger church. It is our time to be challenged, to see anew and to believe more fervently that the reign of God can only be characterized as being about unconditional love. Anything else is pure nonsense. I think about our nation. It challenges us to move beyond a way of living that relegates the poor to suffering and exploitation. Unconditional love shines a light on the injustice that one person can access the gold standard in healthcare treatment, and at the same time, over 200,000 people die from the very same virus. There is something critically wrong with that picture. And there still remain arguments around unified national healthcare prevention. And there continues to be partisan attempts to dismantle the one system that we do have that exists, suggesting no alternative plan. We cannot have peace without justice for all people. In a world of us and them, Richard Rohr observes, people on the right tend to be perpetually angry, fearful, and overly defensive. People on the left tend to be perpetually cynical, morally righteous, and very often outraged. The gospel calls us beyond those two falsehoods, oversimplifications of who we are and who we can become as human beings. Our mission will need imagination and courage. And that need has to be reflected within the leadership of our church. Our faith in Christ remains the same. How we journey is already different. It's just a matter if we want to recognize that and adjust accordingly. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side. Your rod and your staff give me courage. Peace. It does not mean to be in a place, to be that our nation or our church, where there is no noise, no trouble, or hard work. Peace. It means to be in the midst of all of those things, all of the turmoil, all of the pain, all of the inequities, and still be able to calm your heart in the midst. Gandhi reminds us, I remember that all through history, the way of truth and love, The way of truth and love has always won. In these challenging times, let us always remember that. We ask you now, for those of us who share this journey of following Christ, let's take this opportunity to renew our own baptismal promises. We believe in God the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, God's Son, our brother, who was born of Mary, was crucified, died, and was buried, who rose from the dead and now shares in the fullness of the glory in heaven, we do believe. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who continues to work in the world and empowers us to build up God's kingdom here on earth. We do believe. We believe in our community of faith, the church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, and the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. We do believe. This is our faith. This is the faith of our church. We gladly profess it through Christ Jesus, our brother. Amen. As we continue our celebration, I want to thank Lee and Grant Vague for their offertory music today. It's a song entitled Close to the Heart. So as we prepare the gifts today, I would simply invite you to settle back and enjoy our good friends, our father and son duo, again, Lee and Grant Vague.
And the men who hold high places must be the ones who start to mold a new reality closer to the heart, closer to the heart. The blacksmith and the artist reflected in their art to forge the creativity closer to the heart. Closer to the heart. Philosophers and plowmen each must know their part to sow a new mentality closer to the heart. Closer to the heart. Oh! Chart sailing into destiny closer to the heart, 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 yeah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We have lifted them up.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Gentle and loving God, as we gather once again around this familiar table, we give you thanks for the gift of our faith, We give you thanks once again for the reminder of your presence with us at all times. We join today with all the holy children, all the holy women and men throughout all of time, as together we say, Holy, Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the source of all that is sacred. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time in which he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and he gave you thanks and praise. Jesus broke the bread, gave the bread to his family and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." When supper was ended, he took the cup, and again he gave you thanks and praise. Jesus gave the cup to his family and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is a cup of my blood, the blood of the new and the everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all people, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. And therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church throughout the world, and bring us to the fullness of all love and charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Archbishop, and all of your people. Remember also all of our brothers and sisters who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, Saint Joan of Arc, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you forever through your Son, Jesus Christ. I invite you to please join with me through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor is yours, Almighty God, forever and ever. Again, invite us, if we could, to join together in a prayer that is so familiar to us as we gather around this table. Wherever it is that we are gathering today, let us join together and pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. invite us, if we would, to please join in our Eucharistic peace prayer. Again, these are the words of Pope Francis. Let us pray. O God, bread of life, remind us that bread is not made from a single grain, but from many grains. Help us to be a community that no longer thinks of me, but rather us. May we always share our bread with others and accept the companionship of all who shared bread with us. In this we shall find true peace. Amen. Let us pray. Gentle and loving God, once again we give you thanks for the opportunity to celebrate your life and your love. You are for us a good shepherd, a presence of love, of unconditional love that is with us at all times, whether we realize that or choose not to. We give you thanks for your faithful presence. We are reminded today that we are the body of Christ, and we are called in good times as well as in troubled times to bring your love, your justice to the world in which we live. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God continue to bless us, and I ask that blessing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Again, I want to thank Linda for being our reader this morning. And again, I invite everyone to embrace this time in our life, again, to find joy and to find peace. Have a good week.
Oh, the sun's gonna shine, my life once more. Love's gonna live here again.